All right, guys, we are back for round two. We have Sean Carroll on the right playing Jeskai Midrange. We have Daniel Wells on the left playing Red Green Ponza, a.k.a. Land Destruction.
Yep.
This is going to really come down to whether or not Sean has enough counter magic and aggro before Daniel destroys his lands. And if whether or not Sean knows that Daniel is going to be trying to play cards like Magus of the Moon and Blood Moon.
I think Sean is familiar with what Daniel's playing. Daniel's every time he's on camera, he's just like, "Hey guys, look!
I have cool, exciting cards. I think I saw Hunt Masters of the Fell on the main board, which is something I can get behind."
Spicy. So Forest and Utopia Sprawl Island. Sean says Island Go.
See, the only spell that Sean could be representing here would be a Spell Snare, and it looks like Daniel's not going to be walking into it. Gonna play a turn two Stone Rain.
Is it Molten Rain? No, Molten Rain.
Sean's just like, all right, peace.
Float a blue.
And this is gonna be Daniel's strategy for the rest of the game. Hi, Sean. That's a nice land you have there. It'd be a shame if something were to happen to it. Sean's gonna play a fetch land, hopefully this turn, and that way he's not just immediately Stone Rained.
I don't know. Like, if Daniel plays an Island and he gets to avoid slam the
Daniel could untap right now and just slam a Blood Moon.
Yep. Does he? All right. So Daniel's gonna fetch from 20 down to 19.
Looks like he's gonna main phase fetch down to 19, which means he's probably got a 4-mana spell here. I saw Chandra in his hand, not the new Chandra,
the Pyromaster.
The 4-mana.
Still a solid play.
Yep.
19 down to 17.
A lot of decks used to play this version of Chandra before they found the new Torch of Defiance.
Right. And I'm still not clearly convinced that the new one is better than Pyromaster.
It's interesting. They both have different game plans, but the new one I think might be better for Daniel Wells' style of deck, because if you're going to be constantly ramping and trying to destroy lands, you can start... Creeping Moss?
Yeah, let's bring that one up.
Creeping Moss, destroy another land, and Daniel gets to search for a basic and put it into play.
Creeping
Mold?
I don't think that's it.
Oh, gosh.
All right, it destroys a land.
It destroys a land, but not only does that, it allows Daniel to search his library and put a basic into play tapped.
So it's a ramp and
LD spell for 4 mana.
Seems strong. Yeah, you got us on that one. Okay, we'll get the name of that card in between game one and game two. That is, if Sean isn't so demoralized that he allows a game two.
So this is normally something that Sean likes to do to his opponents, is just lock him out. Daniel's going to tap 4 mana here. Is he actually going to deploy a win condition?
We will find out. So Chandra, I saw an Inferno Titan as well.
I saw that too. Maybe if Chandra is able to zero and find Daniel a land here, he could potentially play that next turn.
So Chandra Pyromaster has never been a modern staple, but it used to see a lot more play than it does now.
Yeah, so Chandra used to find slots in John's sideboards and main boards as a repeatable way to
kill Lingering Souls.
Pressure infect players' hands by forcing them to use their protection spells
on
their main phase and then maybe again on the combat step.
Also generate advantage in fair deck mirrors.
Yeah, zeroing was really powerful. Just a way to get you to draw maybe two cards a turn before two extra cards in sequence of turns before she dies.
Is a mirror breaker for like Jund. And
yep.
It's also like it gave them a trump against Obzon, because when Jund was big and then Obzon came on the scene, like Lingering Souls kind of blew that matchup apart, and then they got this card, which let them draw cards and answering Lingering Souls.
Right. And honestly, it just is probably going to end up... Oh, it looks like Daniel's going to start ticking her up to do a little bit of damage.
That is a win condition. That is fair.
It's a slow one, but it is one.
Okay.
We're going to play another Utopia Sprawl. Basically a ramp spell. Tapping for... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 mana. It's just 4 mana.
For a Hunt Master of the Fells, we're assuming here.
Yeah, Sean, I don't think you can spell snare the Hunt Master of the Fells.
Nope.
So Sean's looking to probably... Yes, Bulbasaur re-enters the battlefield.
So Daniel goes from 17 up to 19 and gets a 2-2 Wolf token, which is represented by Bro Bulbasaur.
Sean's probably looking to spend one of those bolts at end step here
on the
Hunt Master.
I don't know. Bulbasaur's pretty threatening. I can respect either one.
Bulbasaur can be pretty terrifying, but that Hauntmaster is probably would probably threaten Sean's life total a whole lot more.
Sean's gonna fetch from 18 down to 15, getting a steam vents off the Scalding Tarn, and bolt the Hauntmaster of the Fells.
Yep.
That I remember Pro Tour Hawaii when Brian Kibler won with Wolf Run Ramp over Palo Vito Dominarosa in the finals, and Hauntmaster of the Fells exploded. You could not find that card anywhere.
I still have one hiding out in my Jund sideboard frequently for like burn and mid-range grinding.
I have one in my Kiki Court sideboard.
See, that's more spice than in Jund. People expect it in Jund. They don't expect it in Kiki Court.
They should, because the card is awesome, and I play with it whenever I can.
Alright, so Sean's going to casually just play another land and pass the turn over to Daniel.
Daniel's looking at
two Inferno Titans and another copy of the LD ramp spell.
Right, so the Wolf Token is going to get in for two, taking Sean from 15 down to 13. We're going to see an Inferno Titan here, I'm imagining, unless Daniel doesn't want to walk it into a mana leak or something. I think we would have seen the mana leak on the Hauntmaster, though.
Well, if Daniel's heads up about what Sean is playing, he knows that there's not a ton of counter magic, but there is several copies of Spellqueller in Sean's main deck.
Right.
So by choosing to play maybe the Inferno Titan, he actually gets to choose to play around
Spellqueller. Right. Mm-hmm. Daniel's going to plus Chandra, taking Sean from 13 down to 12. And Daniel's considering the spells in his hand, looking to cast something in main phase too.
Yeah, trying to choose. Between I definitely want to cast. Makers. You could also just choose to deny Sean use of his mana and just elect to pass here. I think it's actually just fine of a play.
I generally like those plays. I don't like it as much against the Jeskai deck, which is more comfortable spending a turn not casting its spells because it's more reactive and less proactive.
It does have an opportunity to, you know, still get some value out of a card like Spellqueller by just flashing it and making a 2-3.
Right. Sean's going to fetch from 12 to 10, looking for maybe an island and a plains here. We'll see.
If you choose to go through basics. At this point, you're so far behind on your land drops. I think I don't know if it's worth just searching out
the shocks.
Yeah, well,
or the basics.
Searching out the basics, because you just kind of start to run into a different type of mana denial.
I think it depends on how many of Daniel's land destruction spells specifically target non-basics, and how worried Sean is about Blood Moon.
That's fair.
Because, like, if it's Fulminator Mages we're worried about, we want to grab our basics. If it's Stone Rains we're worried about, it doesn't matter.
It just doesn't matter. We already saw some of those out of
If you're worried about Daniel. Stone Rains, maybe you should grab your basics. That way you're live to draw your shocks. Or if you're worried about Blood Moon, the reverse.
Daniel's just kind of attacking on all the different fronts here. So it makes it so almost all of the lands that Sean has access to are going to have a chance to die.
Beast within. So at the end of Daniel's turn, Sean flashes in Snapcaster for no value. And then maybe on upkeep or at draw, Daniel casts Beast Within, targeting Sean's planes, which Sean will respond with Spellqueller, exiling the Beast Within.
So you know that giant titan that's hanging out in Daniel's hand?
Yeah.
That says...
die target Spellqueller.
Destroy target Spellqueller and target land.
Okay, so Snapcaster's going to take Chandra from 7 loyalty down to 5. How much does it tilt you that Daniel plays with non-foil snow-covered mountains and foil forests?
It's Daniel Foil. Wells. I'm willing to accept that his choices, both in deck construction and basic land choices, might just be a little bit more out there than your average player. So
Chandra pluses in, sends our last invitational card to the graveyard.
Oh, he is our last invitational card.
Yep.
Come on. How much do you want to see this Infernal Titan come down?
I want to see it come down really bad. And I have terrible memories of losing to this card, and I still want to see Lava Beard happen.
Lava Beard?
Lava Beard. Have you ever looked? He has a Lava Beard.
Oh. See, his No Shave November is a little bit more powerful than the average.
It's intense. Is what it is. Okay, so I think we're seeing Inferno Titan here. We are seeing Inferno Titan here.
And Sean's just kind of sheepishly, like, hoping that...
Look, lava beard.
Yeah. Sean was kind of sheepishly kind of hoping that Daniel Wells may not have noticed the spell queller on that side of the battlefield.
And it looks... With all of his ramp, Daniel has... Okay, so Inferno Titan and killing the spell queller, which lets Daniel cast Beast Within, which blows up Sean's planes and gives Sean a 3-3, which Bulbasaur represents 2-2s, and obviously Ivysaur represents 3-3s.
So where are the 4-4Bs going to go?
I guess Venusaur. Venusaur, yeah.
So. Well, at least Sean has a casual blocker if Daniel Wells forgets that...
He won't.
Yeah. So gets the lava beer trigger.
When Inferno Titan attacks, he gets to bolt, distributing the damage as he will, which he can assign all three to the beast, and then the 6 damage will get through before Sean can declare blockers.
An arc lightning, if you will.
An arc lightning, yes.
Mm-hmm. And then with fire breathing, I think Sean just may be dead.
Yeah, and Sean realizes that play is live, so he just takes the opportunity to
attack.
Okay, so and Daniel's going to play around Lightning Bolt by not blocking.
He's so far ahead here, he understands what's going on. There's no reason for him to block and maybe lose to a...
Yeah, because that's a play that could get Sean back in the game.
Yeah, so one of the other reasons that Daniel chose to attack Sean's sources of white mana is really the only way that Sean has to get the Lava Beard or Infernal Titan off the battlefield are cards like Cryptic Command or Path to Exile. Yeah. So...
So
we're just going to zero and
zero Chandra
land.
And
so one of the key differences between this version of Chandra and Chandra Torture Defiance is when they zero or Torture Defiance ticks up and exiles a card, this version of Chandra can actually elect to choose any lands off that.
Yeah,
the new Chandra has to cast the spell.
This one just says play. You may play the revealed card, which
correct.
Is the distinct because lands are put into play. They're not cast.
So,
they're not spells.
Okay, so Sean allowed the 3 damage to go to himself and then move to block, or before blocks, flash out a Snapcaster Mage to just, you know, not die to the Inferno Titan.
So I think Sean is actually at 6 here, and then Daniel's following up with a Planeswalker. I want to say it's a Garruk Wildspeaker.
It's a Wildspeaker. So it's one of the promo versions of Wildspeaker.
And
he's
going to
find a Beast
it.
Token, and you know what? He's going to
look
at Sean's Ivysaur and just say, hey, I got one better for you. And then he's going to... Daniel Wells always having it all with the...
is that Mizzium
Mortars? Yep.
I remember that card.
Yep. With all the mana generation he has. Yep, so we were right. Sean's sitting at 6. And I think this is where you start to enter the tap-tap concede portion of the game. Nope.
All
right. Sean, just slamming down the 2 points.
Sean's going to reduke it.
So
no concession.
One of the outs that Sean has here is running Cryptic Commands.
Yeah.
Into maybe something like a Supreme Verdict to clear the board.
I mean, he still has to deal with the Chandra.
Yeah, that's a 4-turn clock.
I mean, he could bounce the Chandra, but...
You're digging deep.
Yeah.
Looking for Sean's...
You're out on the
choices.
Beach with your metal detector, looking for outs. It looks bad. There's kids playing hacky sack who are like making fun of you. You don't know what's going on.
Are you having flashbacks to your summer vacation?
Yes.
Okay,
so in the upkeep, it looks like.
Yeah. So we're just gonna search out another basic land here. Still looking
more
at attacking
mana.
For at least. It's still lethal on board with the
with
beast
the Chandra plus one and then the beast.
So Sean's just saying, hey, Daniel, do you see the line? We'll see a concession here in just a moment, as I'm sure Daniel will find the available line. So he's going to... What's going to happen first? We're going to...
I imagine he's going to...
So Daniel's just trying to fake us all out, moving his hand over each individual card. Oh,
did
we
he
have
draw
a Lightning Helix.
Was it Lightning Helix?
It is a Helix, actually.
Oh,
so,
in Sean's hand. Okay.
So depending on what Sean wants to do here, he has... Oh, no, he doesn't have access to white mana.
Yeah, because of the Path to Exile. So Sean's going to go from 4 down to 1.
And there's the
top.
All
right, so Daniel Wells is up a game over Sean Carroll, red-green lane destruction... over Jeskai Midrange.
So I knew what card Daniel was playing. I just couldn't think of the name. I'm going to let you try and pronounce this, Ryan.
It's Wonvoli Acid Moss.
So Wonvoli Acid Moss, for two green green. Says at sorcery speed, destroy target land, and then you may search your library for a forest card and put that card into play tapped. Shuffle afterwards. Mm-hmm. And Ryan here is going to spend a quick moment and replace our Inferno Titan with the Acidic Moss, so you guys can take a look at the card.
It's one of the beautiful card design choices from the Time Spiral block.
I feel that there's a hint of sarcasm in your voice, Ryan.
I mean, I wish I could have been playing back then to do some drafts and play some standard.
But I wanted to be a fly on the wall as they sit there and try and make that design that set and try and push the boundaries of what Magic.
Time Spiral is interesting enough, but it wasn't even the one that's regarded as the real crazy one out of that block.
This is true. So, what cards do you expect to see Sean Carroll bring out of, a Jeskai midrange kind of build? You have access to three of the most powerful colors in Magic, which give you a lot of different options in sideboarding. What do you think you could see?
It's hard to say. Like, I imagine when Sean's looking at his 75 for a Friday Night Magic, this is not a matchup that he's considering. And if he is considering it, maybe he's just like, okay, that's my loss.
So I would expect Sean to bring in some additional counter magic. If you looked at a lot of Daniel's spells, he's tabbing out very heavily. He's looking to try and resolve these big haymakers and ride them into victory. Cards like Negate and any other permission that Sean may have probably is viable in this matchup.
Yeah, and I'm guessing your lightning bolts are coming straight out.
Yeah, lightning bolt seems pretty poor. What
about Path? I mean, Path is an answer to Inferno Titan, but do you take the philosophy that if you're at the point where Titan's on the table, you're already lost, and you just want more counter magic? Or
I think it's an option just to trim on them.
Sean has two in his hand, so you know
what's scary about that? He had a one lander against the LD deck.
Yeah, you probably don't keep that. Yeah, and Sean agrees.
So Daniel probably just loading up on more good spells, more haymakers, more things that Sean has to be forced to answer every single turn. Copies of Huntmaster of the Pels. Maybe Sean to Torture Defiance is also in his sideboard. He has access to Blood Moon, and there's one right there. So Daniel's goal in this game, too, is to be constantly overloading Sean's counter magic, permission, maybe enchantment removal.
Right.
I expect Sean to have a copy of Wear and Tear that would definitely come into the side from the sideboard. Maybe a copy of Disenchant. You just saw the Negate Spell Queller, and it looks like Sean may have just only trimmed gently on the bolts. Bolt can still be used to answer some of the creatures.
Daniel's deck negates almost completely one of Sean's primary win conditions in Celestial Colonnade.
That's awesome. Just naturally. You have the LD spells, you might have the Blood Moon.
Somebody who's played this deck a long time, have you ever lost to a Celestial Colonnade? Probably not.
Wait. Me as a... As a
no, it's just player? I wish I could ask somebody who's played the Ponza deck for a long time.
Oh, if they've ever lost to a mainland?
Probably not. Especially not the one that's, essentially six mana to activate.
Yeah, I agree. So, Daniel Wells here playing Utopia Sprawl, probably naming green, maybe red, depending on what's in his hand. Sean going to untap, move to a draw
step. I see a purple checklist card in his hand.
All right, so Sean just taking two here, indicating to Daniel that he probably has some kind of permission.
Right. How good do you feel if you negate a Utopia Sprawl?
So this may have been why Sean left some bolts in. Maybe he saw some earlier games and knew that Daniel was playing cards like Arbor.
I mean, when you see these enchantments, that's logical. I wasn't considering that.
Sure. So we're on one land. Yep. Daniel with a top deck.
It's a lore one, so that's plus two mana.
So do you think that Daniel named red, or was it? He must have named red.
I would imagine he named red, yeah. All right, so Stone Rain.
Wait, Stone Rain costs double red, doesn't it?
No, it's red and two.
It's red and two.
It's red and two. Molten Rain is
red.
Okay. So Sean negates that, plays the land, passes back. Sean looks to be in a good position here.
Yeah, maybe. Sean thinks he's in a good position.
Until Daniel's mana gets unlocked. All right, Stomping Ground. Daniel's goes from 20 down to 18. Well, they're both at 18, so it's tied game, right? That's how this works. Life totals are telegraphing who's winning.
So we're going to 4 mana.
Huntmaster. All right, you can't negate that.
No.
spell queller you can exile, though.
That's not bad. And see, this is one thing that's going to be very key to Sean winning this game, is finding some way to generate some tempo and put a threat onto the battlefield.
He has to put Daniel on the back foot.
Agreed.
Mm-hmm. And this is a way to do it, because now he's put Daniel back a turn, and he gets to have a threat in play. Yeah, he fetched from 17 down or 18 down to 17.
Yeah, Sean just. I wonder if Sean forgot that Daniel plays Blood Moon.
Maybe, or Sean might say.
And he has the basic plans and a disenchant.
He may just say, "I'm not beating Blood Moon this game. I'm gonna give myself the best chance to win the game, not considering Blood Moon," which is you have to do sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah. Agreed.
All right, so Spell Queller in for two. Daniel Wells from 18 down to 16.
Sean, do you have a main phase? Oh, just a gentle Serum Visions here.
That was his only fetch land. So he's naturally had two Celestial Colonnades and a Steam Vents and one fetch land, which means he can't get a Plains off that fetch land, so he probably would lose to a Blood Moon regardless.
Oh, yeah. I guess at that point your outs are so few. You're looking to just Raw Dog Snapcaster Mages or... it does give you a chance to leave your negates and some of your gentle, your soft permission live.
Right. Okay, so Hollowed Fountain is going to shock down Sean down to 15. Did they miss?
Yeah, Sean should be at 15.
Yeah, okay. Kessig Wolf Run, another Brian Kibler Pro Tour winning card.
It just turns every single one of your threats late game into a must answer.
Yeah, in Standard it was Inkmoth Nexus.
That sounds awful.
Yeah,
did you ever die to an Augur Bolas that was like a 20, 23?
That was the season that I stopped majorly playing Standard.
And started Electrode moving more and more towards Legacy and Modern.
Yeah. At that point I was trying to get Modern tournaments happening. It's like, guys, this format is awesome. We should be playing it.
Okay,
so Chandra Pyromancer again. I believe Sean has a negate in his hand. Did he use that negate?
He's used one of them.
I know he had a second one. Sean's reading. Sean's like, do I care about this card? No.
It does not kill a spell queller, which is probably it doesn't, really important.
But it could potentially draw a card that does.
This is true. So I think Sean has a Lightning Helix here, which he may elect to go ahead and burn all those on the Chandra and then use the spell queller.
Did Daniel plus one with the Chandra?
Yep, plus one.
So Sean should be at 14.
Gaining three back up to 17.
Okay, so let's update these life totals. All right, Spellqueller is going to attack the Chandra and kill it. And Sean's just going to pass turn. All right, Daniel Wells is in main phase one. Cast Kitchen Finks. Boarded in against the control deck, I'm assuming. And Sean's looking at his cards, considering if he has a response. I think he has negate and something else in his hand. I'm not sure what. All right, second spell queller, so he's going to exile that Kitchen Finks. So Daniel will not gain any life as it doesn't enter the battlefield. And Sean's position is looking good. He's got a healthy number of lands. He's got two threats in play. Brain did step downstairs to get those life totals adjusted, so we do have Sean at 17 and Daniel at 16, and here comes the Blood Moon and a negate. So luckily for Sean, he did hold that second negate in his hand. And Brain, as we were talking about earlier, he may also just not have been fetching basics because he had that second negate in his hand.
Yeah, I don't know. A lot of times Ponza deck can play as many as seven Blood Moon effects. So
true. Daniel did just play a Blood Moon and it got negated.
I saw. All
right. So we're tapping and then a lot of mana. Sean detects for four. Daniel's down to Primal Command.
So do you know what Primal Command does, Ryan?
Yeah, it lets you return a permanent to the top of its owner's hand. You get to search for a creature, gain seven life, or shuffle a graveyard.
Very good.
Yeah, I know what the green command does.
It's non-creature permanent.
Yeah,
so
you get to put a land on top of their deck and deny their draw step.
It looks like Daniel's electing to do that, targeting the Celestial Colonnade.
Right.
Kind of time-walking the land drop a turn.
Sean's going to float a mana and then let that happen. And then Daniel's going to search for maybe Inferno Titan. That's the promo one.
Is that a promo Inferno Titan?
Yes, the promo one. We actually, it's funny. While the Titans were in Standard, there were four promos, all of them except for Primeval Titan. And then he got a promo, like, as they were leaving Standard in the Grand Prix promo. It was so sad.
Wasn't he one of the most heavily played Titans as well?
He was the most heavily played Titan, but they all saw play.
Wait, all five of them. All right. So Sean, okay. So Sean at the end of turn here chose to snap our Restoration Angel in, just Restoration Angel in, while not choosing to target any of the Spell Quellers.
Right. I think before this attack, Daniel was actually at 12. I believe the last combat step, they didn't update the dice. And then with that one, he's 7. So I believe he's at 5. I believe he's currently at 5.
So this restoration, or so this Inferno Titan is going to come down. And
he can nuke.
You can, either the Spell Quellers just says, here, gain 2 life.
Yeah, and the Wolf Token isn't a blocker on this board.
But that 2 life is not lethal.
So right.
Puts it,
right, so yeah, like, so he's going to go ahead and do the one that gets him the Wolf Token anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So Huntmaster takes him from 5 up to 7. I believe 7 is the correct life total here.
Yep.
And yep. Sean, yeah, all right.
Good job, Brian.
Yeah, I can count.
So at, for an out here, Sean has access to another land, a Bolt,
yep,
Helix.
Yep.
Snapcaster Mage.
Lots of, and a mountain.
Draws a mountain. The mountain is lethal.
Because he gets to activate Celestial Colonnade. Oh, did I curse Daniel? I think I did. I feel bad.
How often does the land destruction deck lose to a Madland?
At least once.
On camera.
I'm sorry. Okay, so Sean Carroll ties it up in the story of the ages. We have Daniel Wells on Red Green Ponza and Sean Carroll on Jeskai Midrange tied at 1-1. We're going to game 3. That was magic.
You have this habit.
Yep.
You have this habit where you talk about one of the least likely things to happen.
Then it happens.
And then like 12, 14 turns later, we're looking at the board state and we're suddenly reminded and you're like, this never happens, guys.
Then it happens.
Yep.
I just soak it in. Soak it in. All right, so it looks like Mr. Wells is reconsidering his sideboard. I'm not particularly familiar
with the red green land destruction's main board and sideboard choices.
Yeah, at all, actually.
It's there's a lot of Anger of the Gods in the sideboard. There's a couple other answers to like troublesome permanents cards like Ancient Grudge, maybe an extra land destruction spell or two.
Right.
It's like Pithy Needle. They don't necessarily want to get their enchanted land ghost quartered, so that's an option
right.
that they could pursue. But really,
Crucible of Worlds. Maybe,
but
I don't
really,
know.
Daniel here. We've talked about this before. Daniel is not the control deck. Daniel is the aggressive deck here. Sean has to actively control and mitigate the impact of Daniel's spells on his ability to be able to play the game.
Yeah, I can see that. I can see an argument for the reverse, though, where Daniel's the control deck and he's trying to control Sean's land, his mana, and then eventually drop a bomb like an Inferno Titan to win.
I think he's just on a, like, I wouldn't call it control, though. You're trying to lock up and present a problem permanent or enchantment to stop Sean off of his game plan, where Sean's just like, I'm trying to stop you from LDing me. Stop you from restricting my mana so I can play my creatures and try and kill you over a very long game.
It's definitely worthy of a discussion. I don't think it's obvious.
Yeah, this isn't your what you're used to seeing on maybe the top tables at a, you know, at a GP, modern GP.
I do think, like, so Jeskai has a bit of an identity crisis right now, and then there's the Nahiri decks, there's the Spell Queller decks, like, there's not really, like, a Jeskai deck like mm-hmm. there used to be. But I do think that this list is good, and you could see it coming up the ranks.
I think Spell Queller is actually in a really good tempo position in Modern, as long as you're not playing around a bunch of Lightning Bolts.
Right.
Because then you run into this chance where you get this Cascade of Removal,
All right, you spell colored my lightning bolt. Well, I'm going to kill that one, and that one's going to kill that one, and now I got my spell back here.
I like those stacks. I like spell queller stacks. They're fun. I've had many judge calls since that card has been printed. More in modern than in standard, actually, though. We have lots of players that are experimenting with that card in decks from Jeskai to Blue White Tempo to Kiki Cord.
Are you trying to play it in Kiki Cord?
No, but Daniel Murkowski was at one point.
Okay. I mean, I think it's worth trying. And FNM seems to be a very good
Band
place.
Company.
To try out weird little cards that haven't really cemented their position in modern yet.
The riffle just hurts me. My bones
all
ache.
All those foils in there.
Oh, my bones!
Yeah, Daniel's been playing for a long time. He keeps all of his cards. He doesn't sell or trade anything. He's just going to riffle all of his cards every day.
Yep. It's my bones. They ache. But it's okay.
Yeah, at least it's not all foil in Japanese.
Yeah, that'd be absurd. Looks like our players are having chat.
Oh, just Sean probably saying, no, you don't get to draw five cards. Or, no, you don't get to draw seven. Daniel just mulling a six here, see what
Sean,
he can get.
Daniel probably politely asked him, hey, you want to draw this game and go to another one, and I'll just...
You better Daniel's hungry and wants to go to the food court.
Yeah, we're under 20 minutes for the round, so... I think the mall's open to 10 tonight.
Yeah, both these players are playing at a relatively good pace. We'll likely see the end of this match.
Okay.
Not go to turns.
Daniel shocks himself from 20 down to 18 and casts Utopia Sprawl on Stomping Ground.
There we go. I was a little surprised by this. Sean taking advantage of one of the new lands from Kaladesh, Spirebuff Canals. It is the completion of the Fastlane cycle.
Right. This gives you the enemy colored ones.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised that a deck that's playing Celestial Colonnade is also playing these come into play tap lands on turn 5.
True, but you also, like, you have blue and red spells that you would like to cast on turn 1?
Yeah, but...
I mean, it is a tad greedy. I agree.
Maybe, again, this is just something that Sean's giving a little try out as we're sitting here at FNM just before he chooses that he wants to keep this in his main deck and say, you know, the Players' Championship or something like that. Sean passing after spending a little time deliberating on his Serum Visions. Oh, Daniel doesn't have a second land. He kept that six-card hand on the premise that the Utopia Sprawl Stomping Ground would be enough. Sean playing a Hollowed Fallon tapped and simply saying, go. This bird's not long for this world, though, as it gets bolted by Sean at end step. Daniel Wells drawing for turn, hoping to find himself access to another land. Looks as though he said, draw, go. Sean cracking this fetch at the end of turn to save a little bit of life and thin out his deck. I don't know, the land destruction deck has a hard time when it doesn't draw its lands to cast its spells to destroy Sean's lands.
Right. I mean, it's not like in Legacy where you're like giving up brainstorming and pondering this ultimate card filtering, but you do, like, the blue decks in Modern... Well, don't have as powerful cantrips. They do still have cantrips to let them see more cards.
One of the problems with this is, land destruction does a really good job when it's ahead, and it can, you know, leverage its ramp spells to start cashing these big land destruction.
It doesn't have catch-up cards like Supreme Verdict or Cryptic Command or...
Right, and then once their opponent has an opportunity to use some of their mana and generate threats, they're already too far behind.
Right.
Yep. Sean getting real aggressive here, going snap bolt at Daniel's end step, and Daniel being forced to take an additional 2 damage from the stomping ground, taking him down to 11, so he can maybe cast one of the... See, this is going to be one of those LD spells. Sean might just let this resolve, depending on what he's targeting. Like, it's not going to have that great effect. Daniel can't cut him off of anything.
Yeah, and Sean might have a couple of lands... in his hand. I'm tilting my head right now to get a better look, and I don't know why, because that's not how this works.
So he just floated a blue here, and he's probably
gonna
floated a white here.
Lightning helix, yeah, taking Daniel from 11 to 8.
So
and Sean up to 20.
Bolt. Sean just on a full-on burn.
So that's
plan.
5. Daniel's already in bolt range.
Yeah. So all Sean has to do is draw another Snapcaster Mage, or, you know, if he has another land of Restoration.
Sean is actually at 20. All right, there we go.
got Wear Tear, a land. I think that's a Blessed Alliance to maybe get Daniel to sacrifice.
I like that we're seeing more of these standard cards. Like, they, you can make arguments that upping the power level of these standard cards is bad for the standard format, but it's good for modern.
I think anything that has modal decisions, like modal, like any kind of charm,
yeah,
may not always, but at least has a chance.
Yeah, even like some, you see Obzon Charm pop up here and there. Like this, mm-hmm. if it gives you options, and mm-hmm. you're not playing in a wasteland format.
Boros Charm found its way.
Yeah. Or a staple.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, so the Mizzium Wars is able to resolve.
Kills the Snapcaster Mage and gets followed up by an Arbor Elf. So he's actually...
Sean doesn't have any way to pressure his life total right now.
Yeah.
So he's looking to just draw a burn spell, whatever. But with his only form of reoccurring damage off the board, maybe Dave can have a moment. Like, Sean hasn't hit every single land drop.
So he's going to pat the Arbor Elf in Daniel's upkeep.
Mm-hmm.
Which, it sounds weird to path a mana dork, but with the Utopia Sprawl on the Stomping Ground, this actually denies Daniel a mana.
Yeah, it's more than one mana.
Well, it denies him two this turn and one in following turns.
Sequencing turns.
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
Right, at least one, because, yeah.
Daniel's got a couple, like, he could potentially just play a Kitchen Finks here.
Blood Moon's a pretty live play.
But then Sean actually has Wear Tear in his hand.
Oh, does he?
So he could have an opportunity to fetch out his basic.
I like Kitchen Finks would be great. Is that? I think I see Primal Command, Chandra.
And I can't get a look at Daniel's other two cards.
It's the.
That's another Garruk, a Wild Speaker.
Yeah, and then the last one is the Pride Lion. That's 5 mana, 3/3, has to be blocked by 2 creatures. I'm kidding. It's a card I used to play with. All right, so Garruk Wildspeaker.
That's going to probably
Sean gives it the thumbs
up. Right?
I would imagine you... Well, I mean, you're not worried about haste creatures. Well, yeah, you are worried about flash creatures,
though.
He
doesn't have anything to generate with a lot of... with that mana. So
true.
He'd be able to untap and make 3 mana. It's not quite...
Although, all Sean's most of Sean's flash creatures do have flying, with the exception of Snapcaster Mage. I don't know. Daniel's just in a bad spot.
So, Sean's... for like 3 turns now has just drawn dead, and after Daniel removed that Snapcaster Mage, maybe we can see a game here.
Yeah, no redraws with Serum Visions either.
So you've got a lot of mana. So if Daniel Wells has enough mana to set up the Primal Command Eternal Witness loop, Sean can at least choose to break it up with the fetch land.
Well, he doesn't have the Eternal Witness, right? Or is that the middle card?
The Eternal Wind, like Primal Command.
Oh, you search for it. Yeah, you get to search for it. Bounce, search for it. Yeah, yeah.
Every turn.
I, for some reason, wasn't thinking that searching for it was an option.
I thought you knew your green command there, Ryan.
I do, but I don't know the interaction, because I've never done that to anybody.
It's not very nice.
I like value Primal Commands.
Go get a Thrawn.
Okay, so if this resolves, this is actually really bad for Sean.
If Daniel has the Eternal Witness package.
Which... I'm sure he does.
And remember, Sean can choose to break up the loop with his fetch land.
Daniel Wells plays aggressive Infect decks in Commander. He has the Eternal Witness thing in this deck.
Well, let's find out. Now, Infect and Commander, really?
Yeah. I mean, he's the ultimate
so
spike.
So Daniel actually just elected to gain 7, putting him outside of Bolt and Helix range, and is going to find...
A Huntmaster? Okay.
Which he can cast this turn.
Well, not locking Sean out of the game completely is still a very strong play.
Yeah, and so...
maybe he doesn't have Eternal Witness in his deck.
No, could not. And it looks as though... This is switching very quickly from Daniel just not drawing any lands to Sean running out of threats.
And he's up to 12 just like that, and went from, like, 0 creatures... A turn and a half ago to 3 creatures.
7, was it 7 power on board with a need to answer card?
Yeah, I felt like
he was... Oh, wait, who's he going to bring in? All right, we got Bulbasaur with Huntmaster.
Because Bulbasaur's the 2/2, and then the 3/3 is the Venusaur. I really think that Venusaur should be an Ivysaur, but I'm not going to go down there and start arguing with them over that.
We know the board state.
Okay, Sean goes from 20 to 17.
Right, untap. Sean's going to untap, draw, looking to draw maybe a Bolt... or a piece of removal for the Huntmaster.
Yeah, now you're... And he went from drawing life to kill Daniel to drawing life to kill half a card.
So that time, Sean just drew an island. Again, Sean just sitting here drawing three or four different...
He has turned the land destruction game plan off.
And I think Daniel may have drawn, but I think Sean's going to give him the flip.
Yeah, we're regular REL here, people. As long as Sean's cool with it, we're cool with it.
Yeah. Taking Sean from 15, putting an extra 2 power on the battlefield here.
Can you tell us Ravager? No, this is just out of curiosity. Do you know Ravager of the Fells text verbatim?
Oh, not. I don't think I can say it verbatim, but when he flips, you target. You do 2 damage to target creature and 2 damage to the player who owns that creature or right. controls that
it's
creature.
Control, yeah.
And then it flips back over with 2 spells.
So Magus of the Moon is going to resolve, but Sean has the ability to float a white in response and then path it if he wants to, which I believe he will probably want to. Although it's rough because he'd really like to get that Huntmaster off the table, especially now that it's flipped.
Mm-hmm. I mean, right now we're looking at, what's that, 3? Yep.
Okay, so, yep, and Magus resolves. We assume Daniel's going to combat, and then Sean uses that opportunity to path the Magus. Keep in mind, we're a little under 10 minutes on the clock. Daniel gets a snow-covered mountain.
Daniel also has a lot of power on the field. So 3 from the Beast of the Venusaur, 4 from the Ravager of the Fells.
Also, next turn, he can overrun with Garruk.
Mm-hmm. A 4 right here, and 7, then 2.
9.
So 6, 9 damage.
Yep.
Taking Sean
to 6.
Now, he has a Blessed Alliance that he can escalate. But here's the thing. That's only going to get rid of the 2/2 Wolf Token.
Right.
I mean, it gains 4, so it effectively mitigates the Ravager of the Fells, and he only takes 3 this turn.
Is his hand Blessed Alliance Wear Tear?
Yes.
Okay, which he's about to
So we're going to escalate for 1, yep. choosing the modes, gain 4 life.
Yep, going down 19.
And choosing to have Daniel Wells sacrifice a creature, which will sacrifice the 2/2, and take 3.
Yep, and take him down to 16. So it's almost a fog. Almost.
It'll take him to 12.
Yeah, after all the damage is done.
Mm-hmm.
And I really like plussing, yeah.
Yep, and then that's...
Because now you're presenting lethal.
He could also just play a Chandra right now.
Yeah. Which he gets to plus the Garruk, then play Chandra.
Mm-hmm. Daniel's just playing. No. So this is our. What is it? What is it, Ryan? How do you pronounce this acid moss?
I don't remember the. It's right here. Monvoli. I believe the M is silent.
Monvoli acid moss. Yeah. Destroying one of Sean's.
You like that over playing the Chandra?
You're restricting Sean's mana sword. Like,
no, I mean, you're only taking him down to... I mean, you are taking him off Cryptic Command.
You're taking him off Cryptic. You're reducing Sean's resources try and catch up on this board state. You're also taking off Supreme Verdict.
Is Supreme Verdict, as I was going to say, is it blue, blue, white, or is it white, white, blue?
It's white, white, blue. Okay. And Sean's going to probably look for another white source of mana if he has a... Hollowed Fountain remaining in his deck.
I think the last time I saw his list, he was playing 1 for this deck.
Yeah, it's already... I think it's gone. So he could maybe choose to just get himself a basic plains.
Yeah.
Now, it does take him off Cryptic Command as an out. But sometimes the plays you have to make aren't necessarily the best plays in a vacuum.
Yeah, he may not even have something like Supreme Bird in his 75 at all.
You're playing a lot of creatures, maybe not. Choosing to get a Steam Vents.
Yeah. The last time I saw his Shock Land configuration for this deck, it was Steam Vents, Steam Vents, Sacred Foundry, Hollowed Fountain.
That makes sense.
But so Sean is
2 spells later, and Huntmaster of the Fells puts another 2/2 on the battlefield.
Yeah, and he
gains him 2 more life.
I love
Daniel
that card.
Daniel has taken this game from
seemingly
unwinnable at 3 life. To 14-11 with a board presence of Bulbasaur, Venusaur, Huntmaster of the Fells.
I love this match. I love that card. Like,
so we have a Lightning. All right, Helix.
So we finally see the werewolf go down, and Sean goes up to 14, tying up the life totals.
Yeah, this match went from Daniel Wells maybe just getting mana screwed out of the game to a very back and forth.
So that's 5, 6. So it's not quite lethal. With 1 from the Chandra, so he has got 5 plus 6 is 11. With 1 from the Chandra, is 12. So he can take Sean to 2.
I think he just might choose to make another beast.
Yeah.
put some more pressure on the battlefield, and then
play. Well, I don't think you overrun unless it's lethal. Yeah, I was just counting the potential damage.
Yeah, so here's going to be a Chandra. He's going to save the Garruk in case Chandra exiles a spell that he wants to cast this turn.
Right.
So say he flips an Inferno Titan here.
Then he gets to plus Garruk, mm-hmm. untap two lands, and cast Titan.
Yep.
Smart. Good sequencing. So taking Sean down to 8.
Oh, no, he just chose to tick up.
All right, getting Thrun. Okay, that's good. That's a really good one.
Hi, Thrun. Untapping a bunch of lands to make sure that Thrun's, not just uncounterable, but also has regenerate in case Sean does have access to a wrath effect.
Mm-hmm. I like Thrun. And that's a shiny.
Thrun. Sean's sitting here shuffling his cards, trying to see if he has any way out of this.
He's lost to this staring card before.
Down, yeah. Staring down a 2-2, a 3-3, Thrun, Chandra, and an overrun. Okay. Come on,
aside,
Daniel.
I have this question. Aside from Gamble, was there ever a more adequately named card
than
the last troll? Not that I can think of.
And I think this is just forcing Sean to
do something.
Blow up his white source. Nah, Daniel's gonna go after the blue mana, trying to take him off Cryptic Command, forcing him to do something.
Yeah, you have to Cryptic now if you're gonna do it. That's fine, because doing the Sacred Foundry, he still has Cryptic Command. Yeah. No.
Okay. All right, so I think Daniel may have locked it up here.
Yeah, because if Sean had Cryptic Command, he had to tap the team right there, and I don't know what else he could do.
Style points. Do you go for the kill with a +1 to Chandra or the overrun?
Overrun!
All right.
There's no option.
You're not a fan of subtlety? Just the pink?
No, I'm a fan of making all my creatures +3/+3 trample. Rawr!
All right.
You play elves. Why are you even asking that question?
Because when you cast Cradlehoof Behemoth, you're not. It's not that you have a subtle line available. He just comes down.
I played Magic before Craterhoof was a thing, and where Garruk Wildspeaker was the best you could do. And I still have feelings for Garruk. We've been broken up for some time now, but it's still a soft spot. I'm kidding. We never broke up.
What are you doing? Daniel chose to zero Chandra, exiling a card that I can't quite see. Has made his way off the site. Ticks up the Garruk.
Yep. I think he's getting fancy.
I hope this is just an Inferno Titan, right?
It might be. Just like 3 damage to the face and then swing for lethal.
No, more.
He's going for the perfect win. Sean can have no permanence.
Sean's probably sitting here looking at Daniel saying, you have lethal.
No.
No? You want my land? All right.
Sean is pro camera magic, and he is of the philosophy that you shouldn't concede on camera.
Daniel's saying, hey, I want." Sean's like, I want this one. And Daniel's like,
no,
shroud.
That troll's wearing a shroud.
Shroud. And Sean's like, all right, fine. I'll hit the 3-3. Right.
Attack.
Yep. This will take
6
Sean
down to 2.
Yep, down to 2.
Sean Carroll has a draw step. No Supreme Verdict mana. No Terminus mana.
Casually slams.
He has mana for Terminus now.
Yeah,
it's tapped.
Next turn.
Next turn. So if
can't even cast
if
the
Daniel forgets to attack, then Sean
has
Terminus. Yeah, he has an out. Yep. All right. Daniel's 2-1 over Sean Carroll.
That's a fun match to watch.
Yeah, that was enjoyable.
A little unsuspecting. We had a game that went from just Daniel drawing no lands to be able to cast his spells. Was seemingly locked up the game by Sean
right.
to a very drastic swing all the way back in the other direction. And we also had a chance to see the land destruction deck lose to a man land.
Right. All right, guys. That took almost the full 50 minutes for the match, so we're not going to have another match for round 2. We'll be back up here soon with round 3 for you guys.
All right. See you guys in a little bit.
Thanks for watching.